Golf isn't everything in my life. I have a beautiful family, I have a wonderful wife and two lovely children. And if on the way home something would happen and I can't play golf again, hey, I've had a wonderful career, but I want to be able to spend the rest of my life with my family and raise them the best that I can and give them all the love that I can. You know, golf isn't everything. And when you're all of a sudden, you have to look at life as God's going to call us home sometime. And I'm going to a special place when I die, but I want to make sure that my life's special while I'm here. And when I'm done here, then my time's done.
We have been following a very scary situation that is occurring right now over the air. A Learjet that left from Orlando, Florida,
flying over the nation's heartland today, apparently without a pilot at the controls or a co-pilot.
This civilian jet with apparently five people aboard lost contact with air traffic control over Gainesville, Florida.
Since then, there has been no radio contact of any kind.
I walked into the office and Gloria was in there and she had this strange look on her face. She was on the phone, and she got off the phone, and I said, "What's going on?" And she said that, you know, she got the weirdest call.
He called just to tell me that some F-16s were following Payne's plane.
And I said, "Well, that can't be right, because Payne would have been in Dallas an hour ago."
Indeed, this was happening, that it was something that the military was doing, because they loved Payne.
So that's when I went over, and I picked up the phone and called his cell phone, and he didn't answer.
There are a couple of military jets that have been following it. They took a look at it. A frosted window in the cockpit, which indicates a loss of pressure.
The occupants of the plane were, quote, non-responsive.
A very well-known sports figure is believed to be on board this aircraft.
I just knew in my mind that it was somebody on the PGA Tour.
And so I'm trying to think, well, who could it be?
Julie said, "I think it's somebody that we know."
They didn't know who it was.
"Where's Mark?" And I said, "He's playing golf. Well, are you sure?" And I said, "Yeah, I'm sure."
"This can't be right. Yeah, this can't be right."
And she said, "It must be Payne."
The most likely theory seems to be some kind of cabin depressurization.
It is presumed that all five people on board are dead.
There is an urgent here, and I want to read this. Golfer Payne Stewart feared to be aboard the jet.
"Oh, well, that's not Payne. That's not Payne's plane."
"This can't be true. This is not happening."
It was just total disbelief.
Called his cell number, you know, just like Tracy did, 20, 30 times.
"Tracy, just tell me Payne's not on that plane." And she said, "He's on that plane."
And Tracy kind of gets my attention at one point, you know, when the F-14s were flying beside it or something, and she goes, "Johnny, it's going to run out of fuel."
The plane is now proceeding on autopilot and will continue to do that until it runs out of fuel.
And it's starting down from the 40,000 feet now, so that means that the end is close.
At that moment, I'm just thinking, I got to go get the kids, Tracy.
We were still waiting for some miracle to happen.
I mean, I turn off all the media and all the news in my car, everything. Turn my phone off. I mean, I'm thinking, what am I going to tell them?
You try to be strong, but yet you realize you're not strong.
I kind of stopped him before we get in the car, and I just, you know, had thought about what I was going to say, and I said, "You know, look, Dad's in some serious trouble."
I didn't want to believe it. I didn't want to believe it. I just didn't want to.
He's in a plane, and everybody's passed out asleep.
What about the children? And he needs to raise the kids. And I mean, she was tears in her eyes.
Aaron is in the front seat, and he sees my cell phone, and he says, "Call Dad. That'll wake him up." By the time we got to the house, it was not a very pretty scene. When we turned the corner, it was on our road, there were several media trucks and police officers and everything, and Chelsea kind of lets out a loud, "Oh, my God."
The plane has just crashed.
Has crashed. This Learjet has crashed.
William Payne Stewart was born January the 30th, 1957, at St. John's Hospital in Springfield, Missouri. And he was named William after his father and Payne after his mother, whose maiden name was Payne, and he was a feisty little toddler, and all his sisters did love him so.
He was a lover, he wasn't a fighter. And when he was a little kid, I always would wrestle with him or fight with him and try to toughen him up a little bit, and that was just not in him to be mean and gruff.
And he just loved being around people. He's just like a lot like Dad, very personable, and he was very down to earth when he was a little boy, and he never lost that, and that's what something I very much admired in him.
Payne was always a prankster growing up and even later in life. He was always pulling something on either me or one of the kids, just constantly pulling somebody's chain just to tease him just a little bit.
He just was a natural athlete, just like Daddy was. He could do any of it. He could, you know, football, basketball, baseball, tennis, ping pong, pool. When he was like 3 or 4, we'd be out here in the yard and he'd stick the golf club up under his arm and reach down on it and swing. Learned to swing like that with those little plastic balls, you know, that didn't go very far.
We belonged to Hickory Hills Country Club, and when Payne was little, like 3 years old, well, I didn't have a babysitter, so I had to take him with me when I'd go out to play golf. And that was a good way to keep him, well, corralled.
My dad could have been on the pro tour back in the 40s. He was that good.
He had a passion every bit as strong as Jack Nicklaus or Raymond Floyd or any of the guys that are playing today. But he was an amateur. He was a great family man. And at the time when he was playing, he didn't want to put his family through that. The money wasn't in the game of golf then.
He was an unbelievable competitor, great guy, but just had a real knack of knowing how to play golf and teach golf.
Payne had a beautiful swing. You know, I give that back to Bill and Sam Reynolds, the two people that taught him how to swing. Payne was mischievous and fun-loving, but I tell you, when his father spoke, you know, Payne always respected and listened to what he had to teach him.
I was born, and my dad couldn't feel that he could support his wife and child on the tour, even though he had some backers here in Springfield, and so he didn't pursue it. But then when he had a son, that was the vision, that he'd go on and do what he couldn't do. So I think he lived his life through pain. Mother was a disciplinarian, first off, because Daddy wasn't ever home. He was gone from Monday to Thursday traveling and selling bed springs. So she's the one that had to do it.
She might not have been the breadwinner, but she was the lady with the stick.
Well, I was determined that my children were going to be disciplined and mind their father, and if they'd ever get sassy with him, they never got sassy with their mother.
So my mom raised us, you know. She'd get me to school or to practice or wherever I needed to be.
All three of us were very domestic just because Mother taught us early on to cook. Mother taught us how to sew, how to knit. She taught us all how to iron, and he was just, you know, he liked home. He really did.
I would say that the Stewart family is a touchy-feely, hug-and-kiss, tell you that you love them kind of family. When Payne grew up, the family went to Grace Methodist Church. They had spiritual roots from the very beginning.
I know that there was a deep belief inside of him that had to be family-oriented. You don't come out of a family surroundings like Payne did, without an inner faith.
Payne was kind of a class clown. He was always in the middle of everything. If you were sitting in class and you got hit in the back of the head with a spit wad, you had a pretty good idea, you know, who was back there, and you turned around and Payne had that Cheshire cat sort of grin.
Greenwood was a small school. It still is, 30 members per class, so that meant 15 boys and 15 girls. And typically, when you got to high school, if you could walk and chew gum at the same time, you were on any athletic team you wanted to be on.
I guess his junior year, he was starting quarterback. And then basketball, the same way as basketball. He played a point guard for us. Look, this is a good all-around athlete, a very coachable young man, a very likable young man.
When Payne came along as a freshman, it was a big boost to the golf team.
We had a fantastic team. I'm not sure that we ever got beat.
other than the state championship.
Golf season came around, and Bill came to me and said, I want to talk to you about Payne. I said, okay. He said, now, Payne knows the game of golf. He's a golfer, and I want you to coach him. I know you're his coach, and I want you to do whatever it takes to make him behave, get him to the, get him on the bus on time, get him home, but don't mess with his golf swing.
One thing that Bill would do in addition, he put Payne in a lot of competition to make it challenging and pretty tense and hot for a kid.
That's what he taught me how to do. He taught me how to compete, and he could stick the needle in me deeper than anybody I've ever been around and turn it quicker, too. He'd get me so mad on a golf course, it was scary. And then he knew he had me, so, and then I'd end up having to pay him a couple bucks at the end of the day, and that hurt worse than anything.
He told me right up front, he said, I'm going to be on the pro tour one of these days. He knew from the time he started high school what he was going to do. His mind was made up.
Well, he went to SMU, which is a Southern Methodist University in Dallas, Texas, and they gave him a scholarship.
Payne was constantly around our fraternity house, and that was my first introduction to Payne.
Payne was a lot more free-spirited. His golf wasn't his first priority.
We had a really good team at that point in time, so he had a real hard time making even the starting lineup or his first year.
Payne's game was very solid in the ball striking area.
And he had an air of confidence about him. It was a little bit of cockiness.
His short game was not anywhere near what it was in the later years. But he hit the ball extremely long back then.
We all knew there was something very special about that swing from the first time we saw it.
They say college is the best years of your life. And I think we tried to make that happen. We had a great time down at school. I'd like to say that studies came first, but they didn't always come first.
It could be said that Payne majored in theory of party. It was party management, according to some, but I don't think you'd put the management there. Payne was just full 100% party.
Yeah, he partied quite a lot. We all did.
SMU has a lot of very attractive co-eds there.
We all had a few beverages from time to time. You know, this is where I don't know how much you want me to get into, but...
Well, I love a good party.
He was really always the life of the party and the center of the party, and everyone wanted to be around him.
Well, his major was real estate. He had a business degree, and his major was real estate. And as I would tell him, and I would tell Tracy, and we've kidded about it for years, it is a blessing Payne could play golf, because if he had to rely on his career in real estate, I don't think he would have been able to feed his family.
Academically wasn't his big focus, but a college degree was very important to him.
Payne is one of the very few PGA players that ever graduated with his class in 4 years. It was not an easy task. He struggled like all of us in school, but he survived.
Up until his senior year, he had not lived up to all the hype and all the everything that was expected of Payne. You know, I don't think he had won any tournaments. And I remember Bill coming down and really having a heart-to-heart with Payne.
He said, well, what are you going to do when you get out of college? You're going to graduate in May. What are you going to do? I said, well, I'm going to play golf for a living. He said, well, what makes you think you can play golf professionally? He says, you haven't done anything in college but have fun, you know? So it ends up, you know, that little bit of prod. I go my last semester in college. I win 3 golf tournaments. Fred Couples and I tied for the Southwest Conference Championship.
He was so cocky at the start because he, right after he was out of college, he played in a professional tournament in Carthage, Missouri, and he won it. Well, he thought, well, there's nothing, this is a piece of cake.
I think Payne went into it at that point in the summer of 79 thinking that the game would be a breeze for him, that the success would continue that he had experienced that spring. Well, as we all know, he faced several obstacles and didn't get his tour card until several years later.
It was 79. I just missed the qualifying school. So I'm out at the club, and I told this guy that I'm working at JCPenney's. He says, oh, you should come down and work at my clothing store. You'll make more money working for me. Well, I'm a stock boy.
You know, I thought I was going to be selling, you know. I'm a college graduate. I can sell.
Like Dad.
Yeah. I'm, you know, painting the bathroom, folding clothes. I can fold clothes, though. I'm good for clothes folding. And so I get my check for 2 weeks' work, $83. Now, I'd just been out on the golf course the day before. I beat some pigeons out of about 150. I went in and quit that day.
The big key to that, I believe, was going to Asia, meeting Tracy, and also seeing how players in other parts of the world got the ball up and down, got it in the hole.
We were amongst the group where our resumes were accepted by the Asian Golf Federation to go over there and play. So East meets West in that regard, in that we would think somebody would turn left, they turn right. In India, we found girls that would follow behind the cows and make cow patties out of their manure and put them up on the wall. And then they would, after they dried, those were sold as fuel to cook on. So to us, you know, that was like, you got to be kidding me. You know, what is the aroma on that food? You know, we're not eating anything local.
We were just hoping he'd get home alive. And, you know, we were hoping he'd do well, which he did do well. But once again, that was pure talent.
Payne and I guess the best phrase would be gloves are off, okay? Anything goes. It doesn't matter. We're 15,000, 20,000 miles away from home. We both had fun.
Well, I was in between jobs at the time, and my brother suggested that I go with him for a three-week vacation.
Payne and I saw Tracy at a cocktail party at Royal Selangor Golf Club in Kuala Lumpur, Malaysia. And we saw her from across the room. And he saw her first and said, wow, look at that.
And I just saw Payne across the room, you know, soon after we arrived there. And he was just the most beautiful thing I'd ever seen.
They went out the first night, and Payne decided he was going to impress Tracy, and this is 1980. He's going to impress Tracy by using one of his credit cards to pay for dinner.
He kept giving the guy credit cards, and he kept coming back and saying, no, we don't take that, sir, sorry. And he just kept giving him another one and another one, and I thought, oh, you jerk, you're just trying to impress me with all your credit cards.
He came in that night, and he came into the room, and his quote to me was, he looked me dead in the eye, and he said, that's the girl I'm going to marry.
I think I knew the first night that this was the man that I wanted to marry, and apparently he thought the same thing.
I think she was the true missing piece to completion of his puzzle.
They made a great team. Tracy kept him going down that right path, and I think she was a steadying force for him, and I think she was an important part of him becoming a great player.
Without Tracy, Payne would have become a good player. He would have never become the superstar that he became without her. And I think if he was sitting here next to me today, he would agree with that.
Early on, Payne was a little bit cocky.
He was brash and he was cocky and he was gonna make it.
He started making decent checks. He knew he had made enough to keep his card for the next year. And then he came to the Magnolia Classic where, even though they say it's unofficial, it was his first tour win against tour quality players.
I'll never forget his comments after he won. He said, well, I think the tour needs more blonde-haired, blue-eyed guys. And I was like, golly, this guy's unbelievable.
Payne was always a little brash, but when he started wearing knickers, boy, he raised some eyebrows.
In 82, I was playing, and I was wearing Izod clothes at the time. And I had on red slacks, white shirt, red stripe in it, you know, looking like your typical golfer. And two guys down from me on the practice tee had the exact same clothes on. And right then I decided I didn't want to look like he did. So that's where the knickers came along. First term I debuted them in, I'm playing in Atlanta on a Saturday. I'm playing with Trevino, a pair of lavender knickers out. You know, I was looking good in them too. And, you know, Trevino busted me a little hard on the first tee, but I expected that, and so, but the comments I got that day were very favorable, and that's probably the reason I've continued to do it.
It was was a great look, and I think Payne was probably the only one that could have pulled it off.
They really are very splendid shoes, aren't they?
When he came out with that stuff, I said, boy, I sure hope you have enough game to back that stuff up.
I used to always kid him about how he felt about going in the Circle K on the way home or the 7-Eleven, and what did the people think of him when he went in there to buy that Coke or whatever, you know?
You know, then when he signed the NFL deal, you know, then it became a game. Because we get into a city, you know, and all of a sudden now we're wearing, you know, we're in Dallas and we're wearing the NFC East, the Redskins, the Giants, the Eagles, the rivals in the division. So, you know, he liked to stir it up.
He loved the people that kind of, oh, you know, if you're in Chicago, we'd have a Packer thing on or something, and they'd give him the needle, but he'd come back with the Bears on Sunday, and you know, that's just the kind of guy he was.
I don't know if it was a subconscious that it would turn into a identity or an icon. I didn't realize that then, but it was probably one of the better marketing decisions I ever made in my life.
Ironically, the first time Payne wore his Knickers all four rounds was in the 1982 Quad Cities tournament.
My most prestigious victory to myself was the Quad Cities in 82 because my father was there and got to see it.
In fact, Jim Thorpe walks up to me. I remember, I'll never forget, on one hole he goes, who is this guy, Payne? Because Payne was just playing awesome.
What a thrill it was. I think his father and I both just cried and cried.
You know, we had a big cry up on the 18th green when it finished. And, you know, that's the thing that we've always had in our family. I've always been a pretty emotional person.
The Quad Cities event was even more important to Payne Stewart because in 1984, he realized that his father was diagnosed with cancer.
We were visiting there in Springfield, and this was, I think, about 2 weeks before he passed away. And we had just found out that I was pregnant with Chelsea.
And he'd told his father that he was going to that he was going to be a father. That's how he told him. And
he went up to him and he whispered in his ear, "I'm going to be a daddy."
Bill said, "Don't have more than two." And Payne says, "Well, what about me? I was the third one."
And his dad just got this big old smile on his face and looked at Payne and said, "Don't buy expensive baby furniture. It only wears out."
That's always one of my most special conversations I ever had with my father, telling him that Tracy and I were expecting Chelsea, and that was special. It was, you know, I look back on that, and I, you know, miss him a lot. I know he's still watching, but I wish I could hug him when I win or whatever, and talk to him personally. It would be special.
I know that his father's death really, really hurt him.
He just felt like, you know, there was no justice in the world. Why would his father, a man that, you know, very athletic man, never drank, never smoked, you know, lived a good life, why should he have cancer? He didn't show any emotion at the funeral, didn't cry, and it was a strange reaction from Payne because he's usually a very emotional person and, you know, never afraid to cry.
And I know he brought his daughter back here one time and went out to the cemetery and did his crying out there with her. He finally could have tears about it after he took her out to the cemetery to pay homage to his father.
I think at that point he became a man in his mind that, you know, he was growing up now and he had children and he needed to do what Bill would have done. Bill was a great, great man.
Dad had given me a piece of paper that he had written out for Payne so that while we were out on tour, I could watch for certain things that he was doing.
It's kind of emotional, but for our anniversary one year, my wife had it framed and gave it to me. And now it sits in my golf room where I work on my clubs.
What a neat thing to be able to see, as much as you obviously still miss your dad.
I wish he'd... wish he could have seen some of the things that I've done.
He'd have been awfully proud, wouldn't he?
I think so.
Pray for a little peace till we meet again someday.
We moved to Orlando in 1984 because Orlando had such a great airport and, you know, it was great weather, so he could practice all year round. Scott and Sally Hoke lived here and we had become friends with them, and they invited us to stay with them after Disney.
You know, we said, hey, you know, be at home and all, and he was. In fact, one morning, I think Sally was up and he comes walking into the kitchen to get some orange juice or something, and he had it on his briefs. And Sally, she just, say, you know, Payne, we're pretty good friends, but I think you need to wear a little more around the house, maybe not make yourself so at home.
Payne Stewart came to Bay Hill a number of years ago. I thought he had just a world of talent. He had a swing that I certainly envied because it was everything that my swing wasn't. It was long, smooth, and very powerful.
Always seemed to be a guy who, when he got to a difficult golf course, always played it pretty well, but never really won.
He was winning a lot of money, but he wasn't actually winning tournaments. He was coming second a lot.
Left it short. Back-to-back double bogeys, and the mania has gone out of the Mustang.
And he got the nickname Avis for second, you know, finishing second. Maybe it should have been for We Try Harder.
It bothered him for a while because he had a lot of good tournaments, but you know, sometimes he just couldn't finish it off, and sometimes he just played well and the other guy just played better.
There goes Payne Stewart. Do you think that's not a lonely walk?
Yes, defeat is always a lonely walk.
There were several losses that I believe really frustrated Payne a great deal. One of them was the 1984 Colonial in Fort Worth when he blew a two-shot lead and lost to Peter Jacobson.
The week before the Colonial, my father went in for surgery on his throat because of cancer. He had a one-stroke lead with one to play. He bogeyed the last hole, I birdied the first hole, turn around, he goes from winning to losing, and Payne came up to me and he gave me a hug and he said, this one was for your dad. He said, tell your dad to hang in there, and I'm thinking of him. And in fact, I kind of tear up when I think about it right now. And he was so kind to me to say that I told my father, and my father never forgot that. And I feel that I will be entwined with Payne Stewart's life forever.
I believe the frustration finally came out of him in 1987 when he won the Bay Hill in Orlando, shooting a then record score.
With the fact that he lived right off the 12th tee, you know, seeing Chelsea as he came by, giving her a hug and a kiss. Not many golf tournaments you can play in where you have that opportunity to kiss your daughter.
When he won Bay Hill, we were all very pleased, and have one of our own guys win the tournament was very special.
After winning Bay Hill, I thought that it was going to be a perfect time to honor my father in his memory, how much he loved, you know, my love for him, what I thought of him by donating all my tournament winnings to the Florida Hospital in Orlando for cancer research patients' families.
When you get to see what it's really gone for and how it's going to be able to help the community and families that had to go through what I went through, and it's really going to be something special.
The thing he liked the most was the Golf Digest cover where it showed the monkey getting off his back.
I think that all of a sudden, Payne took that step where you're near the winner's circle a lot, and then you have some wins, and then all of a sudden it's like you take that next step to where your focus becomes majors.
The Professional Golfers Association of America presents the 71st PGA Championship from Kemper Lakes Golf Course in Hawthorne Woods, Illinois.
We're seven shots behind with nine to play. I mean, you're not really thinking about winning. You're just thinking about another high finish. But he goes out and he shoots 31.
I remember kind of being surprised when I looked at the leaderboard on the last couple of holes because first thought was, where did he come from?
And look at this.
drives a beautiful rolls right in the middle of the hole.
And he has it right all the way and runs it about 3 feet by.
Payne birdies 14, 15, 16, and 18 to shoot 31 on the back nine.
The only regret Payne would have from his first victory is the way he handled himself after he had completed play and Mike Reed was still out on the course.
He was just kind of eating grapes and messing around for the camera. He really wasn't, you know, making fun of what Mike Reed was doing at all. He was just a little immature and didn't realize what it would look like.
We all do things that we look back on and think, geez, how could I do that, especially things on TV.
And there's the 1989 PGA champion, Payne Stewart. It's a heartbreaking moment for Mike Reed.
What people said about it and how he acted, that really is long under the bridge, and the lowest score wins, and he got the job done.
And this is what the game of golf is all about.
Bob, what a wonderful player Payne Stewart is.
He sure is, and he deserves to win a major championship. He'll be a fine champion.
He was a difficult guy to play with. He was always fidgeting around. He was always in his bag. He was always making noises, oblivious to it all.
Payne was not only ADD, but also was very hyper, and he had a lot of impulsive behaviors, which frequently accompany the condition.
Numerous times I had to just grab him and wait till he hits the shot. And he would, because he wasn't paying attention.
He would many times put his foot in his mouth to the press because of his impulsiveness. He would know it just about as soon as he did it, but usually it's too late.
Payne would always blurt out exactly what he felt.
Payne could make things dicier.
Was he a little abrasive at times? Sure.
All of us American golfers on the Ryder Cup team, we are Chinese too. Thank you very much.
And so, well, congratulations, Payne. You just insulted 2 billion people.
I know he never meant for anything to go the wrong way like that. It just, he was good at, like I say, putting his foot in his mouth.
Sometimes you don't always conduct yourself the way you should. And I've bitten the heads off some of the media people when they've come up to me at the wrong time and asked that dumbass question when in that situation where you just, well, how does it feel? Well, you want to go, what do you think?
Payne was not only a good golfer, but a character, in my way of thinking, he was a piece of work.
He did it, Forrest Gump, just like Forrest Gump, you know. He goes, I don't know what to say about that.
Some people are peas and some people are carrots, and obviously this guy's big pea, and I'm big carrot.
No matter where he was, no matter whose company he was in, he enjoyed himself.
He loved to party.
And there was always some kind of music going.
Playing Jimmy Buffett music.
What was his favorite Jimmy Buffett song?
Margaritaville.
Away again in Margaritaville.
He loved to make margaritas. He
made the best margaritas.
Searching for my lost sugar salt.
Payne loved to barbecue.
Was a good cook. I think he thought he might have been a better cook than he actually was.
Always something had to be happening with Payne.
Baseball, softball, basketball.
Wave runner, the jet skis, the boats.
That's what he loved most in life, I think, you know, was coming home and being with his family.
Mischievous, sometimes, you know, it's practical joker.
At Muirfield, you know, all Payne has to do is kind of make a par on this hole and he's got this thing won.
Zinger's in that bunker going. All of a sudden he goes like this, and I'm okay, you got to make this putt to line. And this ball's rolling, and it's rolling, and it's rolling. I don't need to see this again. Miss! Oh, it went in again. I can't believe it. Now all of a sudden I'm going, you got to make this putt to tie. And I didn't make it, and then I missed the next one, which was irrelevant because, you know, who remembers?
Who finished third?
Yeah.
Right.
It was me.
I walked up and said, hey, I'm sorry. He said, hey, don't worry about it. Great shot. You deserve it. Congratulations. Way to go. I go to the 18th green, do my ceremony. He goes down to the press room, says what he needs to say, holding his head high. He goes up in the locker room, stuffs my shoes full of bananas.
He and Zinger were relentless on each other.
There was a stretch where that's all those two guys did.
It was 3 or 4 years ago, and we were at Augusta National. He's kind of over there, and he's got his head kind of down a little bit like this, and he's kind of got his hand kind of here, and I said, what's wrong? And he said, well, he's like, I got a little problem.
I just said, what happened to you?
And I said, what? And he kind of looked up, and I saw his teeth, and they were all, I mean, all of a sudden his front teeth were just, like, messed up so bad.
He just said, man, you didn't hear? I was in New Orleans last week and was on, you know, went on the wrong street. Some guy cold cocked me. I said, oh, my gosh, man, you are messed up.
All I could think about was, man, you're going to have some serious dental work done. I'm thinking, my gosh, your teeth are, I mean, they're ruined. And then all of a sudden, his eyes started twinkling a little bit, and then he started moving those false teeth up and down with his tongue.
And then he yanked them out, and I just said, I've got to get some of those. Those are the best teeth I've ever seen.
And I was like, you know, that is so bad. I mean, he had me. He had me hook, line, and sinker.
It's one of those deals when you get somebody that good, you lay up that night and just laugh for no reason, knowing you got that guy.
There's no question that Payne loved to party, loved to have fun, and loved his music.
I'm a golf fan, yes I am. I'm a golf fan.
Payne was not a very good musician with a group, okay? But on his own, playing the harmonica, he could go.
The important thing was how much he loved it. You know, was he a great harmonica player? No.
You know, kind of turned down his mic a little bit. We had to encourage him not to sing a whole lot. But his spirit was there.
Payne Stewart could sing off key as well as anybody. The thing that he had more than anything, he had energy and he had passion. He wasn't always blowing the right notes, but it was coming out loud and strong.
After the U.S. Open in 91, I tried to improve my golf game to get better. Hell, I was already there and didn't realize it. You know, I was already there. I was at the top. I was doing everything right, and I went and I changed something to get better.
When he won the Open, he said, all right, now I have to be more serious because I'm the U.S. Open champion and I'm going to act accordingly. And I remember he just decided that he was going to be different. Well, it was the worst thing that could have happened to Payne.
So he was, you know, he was kind of a lost person. You know, he wasn't performing at a level he knew he could perform at, and which kind of filtered down into his everyday life. I mean, he was basically miserable to be around.
He was busy, and some of the times we couldn't get it, you know, we'd call and see if we could go out dinner and a movie or something, and then, you know, he said, well, let me check my calendar. It's one of those things, and well, looks like we got a day that we can do that in about 3 weeks.
His attitude was so bad. I mean, he was angry a lot, and he was surly and things like that. And I know that Tracy talked to him and said, look, you know, if you're really unhappy, I said, you just shouldn't be doing this. And at that time, I know he made a commitment to change his attitude.
As, you know, we get older, all of us tend to change in some way or another. And then I guess when I got sick, it had a big impact on Payne's life.
I think that was a big jolt to him to realize that Paul, you know, was so young and so healthy, all of a sudden he had cancer and could die.
His dad's bone scan looked like mine did, and he freaked out when he saw it.
You know, to know that he lost his father that way and realizing just how deadly and dangerous cancer can be. So I think it had a big impact on Payne, and in a roundabout way, it kind of opened his eyes a little bit more to realize, hey, we're all vulnerable to anything at any given time. So certainly to be thankful for what you have.
And he saw the strength that Paul had in his faith, and I think that really impressed Payne a lot.
You can encourage a guy or whatever, about any aspect of life, but when it comes to belief in a living, risen God, you know, I mean, only God can change hearts, you know, and but of course you have to make that decision at some point. And I think that Payne took that upon himself, made that decision, there's no question about it.
I think that prompted Payne to ask me about the First Academy and what it was all about. You know, I just told Payne how great a school it was and how much emphasis they put on Christianity with the kids. And, you know, they brought a lot of things home from school with them and touched Payne's heart with it.
We would have to, you know, help them with their Bible study and everything. And I think that Payne just started to really, you know, look and read more into it. And so Oral Hershiser is a friend, and he was having a Bible study at the church and had invited Payne to come along as well. And he just seemed to grow deeper and deeper into his faith.
As friends of his, you do see him in the down times. You do see him when he's not the life of the party. And so you want to help people like that. And he starts asking questions. You start maybe having a few answers for what's worked in your life. And then there becomes just an ongoing conversation.
And that was really kind of the first time that I really talked to Payne about anything spiritual is when I noticed him wearing the bracelet. You know, Aaron had, you know, given it to him. And what would Jesus do? You know, it was something that he was trying to apply to his life. He did have a sincere and genuine faith in God and in Jesus Christ, and so therefore he wore this bracelet, and it meant something to him.
My family has made me put a perspective on my life that golf is something that I do, but my family is the most important thing.
He just really was so happy to have children. You know, if it was up to him, we would have had probably six of them.
He gave the most important thing you can give to your kids and your family. He gave love, unconditional love to his family.
My daughter, she's in seventh grade and playing on the eighth grade volleyball team at First Academy here in Orlando. And she's going to be a teenager in November, which will be a new experience for a mother and I.
He used to call me Silly Goose because I used to do really dumb stuff.
She was his little girl.
Chelsea was Payne's princess.
She's a great student. She's a great athlete. There's every reason to be proud, but he was just proud because that was his daughter.
You know, they just had such a special relationship.
Payne would go to Chelsea's volleyball games and would just yell and critique every point.
He almost got kicked out of one of my games. He was so loud.
Payne was so embarrassing. He was in the middle. He was screaming, "Go Chels, go Chels!"
Very loud, very loud.
The coaches found a way to silence Payne. And the way they did that was they made Payne the line judge.
Line judges can't say anything. So I was just cracking up because he couldn't talk or anything.
So all he could say was in or out. And that was the way the coaches muffled Payne.
And my son is, you know, the apple doesn't fall far from the tree.
That's not good.
No, it's going to be scary as he gets older. He's 9 years old and just full of a lot of energy.
Who do people tell you look like?
My dad.
He looks like Payne.
If there's a person on earth that's Payne Stewart, it's Aaron Stewart.
He walks like Payne.
The same smile.
He acts like Payne.
Just like his dad.
In his eyes.
If you want to see the spitting image of Payne, you just have to go and meet Aaron.
Is that a good thing?
Hopefully.
He played football. His first year he got to play football, and Payne was a great spectator. I mean, the referees wanted to throw him out every time that he showed up, you know. Aaron would always be challenged, like Payne would throw him the keys or something and he'd drop them, you know, he'd say brick, you know, and he'd just give him a hard time, brick.
He teased me, he called me brick hands. So every time I dropped the ball, he would say, that I've got brick hands.
He'd just say, brick, 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 you know, and Aaron hated that.
And when I would score a touchdown, he would stand up on the bleachers and say, way to go, Brits.
It was the last game of the season, and they were asked to pick names for themselves. And Aaron had picked the name Brick. So they introduced him as Aaron the Brick Stewart.
He also, you know, he was a disciplinarian. He wanted the kids to have values and to do the right thing.
I got to set an example for my kids. I don't want them to act the way I used to act. And hopefully they'll learn from that, and they'll, sometime in their life, they'll say, you know, Dad used to tell me that, not to do that, or Dad used to tell me to do this, or he was right. You know, they'll look, he was right. You know, they'll be growing their family up, and, well, that's what Dad used to tell me. That'd mean I'm getting my point across, and I think that's why I am more mature now.
Payne would just get so excited to play in the U.S. Open each year.
The reason why Payne was always great at the U.S. Open is because Payne Stewart had a great gift for creativity.
It takes real soft hands to hit shots around the greens in the U.S. Open.
I think if we had 42 majors throughout the year, Payne would have won a lot more tournaments.
To win the U.S. Open was the ultimate in golf, in my husband's opinion.
His father had such an appreciation for the U.S. Open and held it in such high esteem.
When he was signing up his applications, he had him sign his full name, William Payne Stewart.
In 1999, Payne was, he was fired up.
I watched the third round from start to finish on TV, and I just said that you're moving your head, you know, on your putting, you need to keep your head down. And he agreed and said, okay, we'll go work on it.
It was good because he needed something, you know, that he could focus on. So it was perfect, just, you know, I couldn't ask for anything more.
Payne played really solid those first three rounds. He had a one-shot lead over Phil Mickelson going into the last round.
I drove him over there and dropped him off, and I said, you know, just believe in yourself, trust your swing, and I said, believe in your heart that you can do it. And he looked at me and he said, I got a big heart. You know, that was kind of a joke between us about his enlarged heart. And I said, I know you do, lovey. You can do it. Kiss goodbye, and off he went.
And from Orlando, Florida, Payne Stewart.
It's almost like match play between Payne and Phil. Actually, by the time they got to 16, Phil had taken the lead. He was sitting at minus one, Payne was even, and they had some pretty tough par putts.
And then he was faced with a putt that was breaking two ways. It was uphill, then downhill, and I was just hoping that he would two putt.
It's like one of those putts that's got a little bit of everything in it, you know?
3,000 to 1, he was going to miss that putt.
I thought, if anything, he was going to have to guard against three putting.
Ooh, that's a double break. That's tough.
Oh, what a putt.
I just jumped and screamed and said, come on, you can do it on the next hole.
He was chomping that gum like he chews, and he had that focus in his eyes.
I'd never seen him as focused as he was, ever.
No, it's not going to move that much. He yanked it.
Now the crowd's into it. Payne's completely focused, and we're all even going to 17.
Get the hole!
What a shot. Oh, what a shot! You're kidding me!
When we approached the 17th green, the crowd was in a complete frenzy. I mean, they were screaming and hollering and yelling.
Pulled it again. One hole to play. Stewart leads by one.
hit it down the right side, just over the trap here. As we got to the crest of the hill, we couldn't see Payne's ball.
How bad is that lie, Roger?
It is no good at all.
It was the worst lie it had all week. He hit a good shot, laid it up just short of the trap.
He said, oh no, it's all
going right of the hole, John.
Well, it looks like pretty much a par by Mickelson, and it's going to have to be a heroic up and in for Payne Stewart, otherwise there will be a playoff.
And I said, where's Payne? And he said, he's out there in the fairway, hitting his third shot. And I went, oh no, here we go again.
Chance to win it.
The walk-up 18 was just a very special moment. The ovation both golfers got that day was just very special. With the bells, as you can probably hear in the background now, they were playing that day. And the combination of the bells and it being Father's Day made it just a very, very unique moment. He was right in this area here, about 20 feet short of the hole, and Phil's was a little further away. He was 35 feet away.
Looking at his putt, I knew that if I were to miss and give him a free roll at the win, that it was very likely that that ball was going to go in.
Borrowed too much. Now Stewart, one putt to win.
We screamed and hollered and jumped up and down. And
I was running around, high-fiving inanimate objects.
I was speechless.
You beauty, he kept saying. You could see him when he grabs my face. You beauty, you beauty.
Came over to me and talked about what a wonderful experience I'm going to be having here shortly, becoming a father.
And I sang out to him as loud as I could, even though he was just a foot or two away. And he turned around and hugged me, and he said, I kept my head down, I kept my head down. I said, I know you did, I'm so proud of you.
Payne loved the Ryder Cups. I mean, he lived for the Ryder Cup.
When they raised that flag and played the national anthem, he got way up for it.
I'm patriotic. That's just, I'm proud to be an American.
And I was with him for a long, large number of major championships over the years. And the Ryder Cup was the one that he got the most up for and got the most excited about and got the most tense for.
Payne's first Ryder Cup was in 1987, and it was not fun.
That was my first.
Absolutely eat him up inside. Oh. To not only lose as captain, but lose at his golf course.
First time ever in the United States at his golf course, him being captain. It was not fun. He didn't sugarcoat anything. He just got right in your face and said, you guys don't know how to win.
If we hadn't played the 18th hole, we'd have won the matches easily. Our guys just weren't finishing. They weren't just going after it. And I think I had to, try to kick them in the rear end a little bit, you might say. And I guess Payne was one of them I probably kicked.
And he got right in my face and says, how come you don't win more? You win all this money. Why don't you win tournaments? And it's kind of like, here I am, a little rookie in the Ryder Cup, and I'm just being, but that's the way Jack is. Jack's not used to losing, and he doesn't accept losing. And so that probably made me a better player.
Payne seen it all in the Ryder Cup. Wins, losses, ties.
Pulls off a remarkable recovery. Payne Stewart's putt has stopped the European rally.
What a shot. This might go
right in the heart. What a comeback.
Understandably, the American jubilation is complete.
One thing he always brought was his music.
Man, when that alarm clock went off, that music was playing so loud.
Queen, you know, we are the champions of the world. And he was cranking down the hallways. I mean, cranking.
Full blast, I'm telling you. And Hero started complaining about it because it was so loud. But, you know, we're loving it. We're eating it up.
And I was like, Payne, we haven't won yet. I know, but we can, and we will.
But that's always been one of my goals, is to be on the Ryder Cup team. And I haven't been on the last two teams, and they've lost. So that's my story, and I'm sticking to it.
And he said, I really want to be on this team.
You got to have people that know how to motivate people and to keep free people from getting down, from playing bad or getting beat or whatever. And I'm that person. I'm a motivator.
Of course, being captain, I very much enjoyed his comments, and hoping that that would that idea would spread, and it did.
It's a record day, record gallery. This putt looks pretty good, right in the middle of the hole. What a golf shot.
My goodness.
Wow. What a match this could turn out to be.
And that was huge.
Wow. 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 Looks pretty good. Wow. Another point for the United States. What a comeback. Well, the little boys come out now. There it is, and Ben Crenshaw knows it. United States has won the Ryder Cup.
He defended Monty that whole day out there. I mean, Monty took some incredible abuse.
Crowd's been was really tough on Colin all day, and we'd won the cup, and that's why I came to win the cup. It's not about my personal, whether I beat him or not. He didn't deserve to have to hit that putt, and so I gave it to him. The cup was over. It didn't matter.
And by him conceding that putt, he proved to the whole world that his own personal achievement did not mean anything to him. It was the fact that we had won the Ryder Cup.
It just goes to show you how far he had come as a person and how thoughtful he was.
It's been a special year, and to win the way that we won today, this completes my year.
Payne had bought my mother a watch several years ago, and my parents were staying with us during the accident. Mum and Dad had gone out to the Epcot Center, and that morning at 9:30, my mother, her watch stopped, and 9:30 was right when they would have all perished.
Her pain, I don't think I will ever see anyone in so much anguish.
The minister came over from her church, and you know, people started to come over, which was great, and I think they weren't sure whether they should go over or not, but it was really good that they came over, and it helped.
But it was so chaotic, so horrible, so painful.
The funeral was unbelievable. I've never felt so much camaraderie as I did that day. And so many hugs, you know, a tear in their eye. I mean, we all had that same heartsick feeling, all of us.
We're gonna laugh and we're gonna cry a little bit, probably, and that's okay.
On Wednesday morning, I spoke to my good friend Vince Gill, and Vince and I just reminisced about Payne. And he mentioned to me that the night before he had written a song for our buddy.
So we found a way to get into the studio Thursday and make this recording, and they were kind enough to include it in the service.
Hey God, I just lost a dear old friend.
The speeches and the talk at the memorial service, and hey, was uplifting, funny at times, everybody crying at times. And it basically just showed the amount of care and warmth that is amongst all the PGA Tour players. It's one big family out there.
1992, Payne had to return the U.S. Open trophy that he'd won in 1991 and had to go to Pebble Beach for a media day. We were sitting in the lounge at the lodge at Pebble Beach, and this boisterous guy came up to us and said, "That guy said, you're Payne Stewart. I don't believe it." Payne said, "Well, if I go get the U.S. Open trophy," he says, "will you keep filling it up with whatever I want to drink? Will that prove it to you?" And the guy says, "You bet I will." So Payne went over and brought the U.S. Open trophy over and turned to the bartender. He says, bring us some bottles of Cristal champagne. And Cristal champagne is very expensive, but at the lodge at Pebble Beach, it is really expensive, I want to tell you.
You had six people that all had the same faith. Bruce Borland was actively involved in the church. Two pilots were, Robert and Van. And Payne was a new believer. It's almost as if God said to these six, you have fought the good fight, you have finished the race, and now I'm going to take you home. And I'm going to impact the world.
I'll never forget the mistake he made when he told me the story of the time that he started his bass boat in his garage. He said he was so happy that it kicked on. He was very surprised, but he kept revving in the engine. Oh, oh, oh. An outboard engine cannot run without water. And it exploded. And then he made the mistake of telling me.
Yeah, I don't know how you could speak at your spouse's, you know, memorial service. To get up and do that is almost superhuman.
Finally, I thank God for Payne. We shed laughter, tears, victories, and defeats. You will always be my soulmate and my best friend. As I look back now, I realize that even after 18 years of marriage, Payne was still the most beautiful man I'd ever seen. Not because of the way he looked on the outside anymore, but because of what was on the inside. We love you. Let the party in heaven begin. Thank you.
There is a depth there with her. That's one strong lady and some strong kids. And the bond that she and Payne had and the seeds that Payne planted in the kids when he was with them, they're going to blossom.
In a very ironic way, Payne's death has brought many people closer together with their loved ones. Made them re-examine their relationships, re-examine their own lives. I know it has with me.
We miss him. The kids are going to miss him tremendously. Tracy's going to miss him. He made a huge impact on a lot of people's lives, and all of us just have to have enough faith to say, God's got a bigger plan.
The fog was almost like you're in heaven. You know, I guess the thing that it still gives me goosebumps is hearing the bagpiper.
I actually considered not playing, but I can just hear, you know, Payne saying, you know, boys, you gotta play in the Southern Twang. You know, Payne was a guy who was a very emotional guy. He loved to laugh, and he wasn't ashamed to cry. And so I know I'm not gonna be ashamed of my tears this morning. Neither should you. You know, six people got on that airplane on Monday. And today, there's wives without husbands. There's kids without fathers. There's a golf world that's missing a hero. There's a tour that's missing a great champion. There's a bunch of people missing a great friend. All of us were a part of Payne, and Payne is definitely a part of us. And when he died on Monday, a big part of us died too.
Another really poignant thing was when the bagpiper walked away, all this dew on the ground, and the fog was just starting to lift, and all you could see were the set of footprints that went down the fairway. Payne Stewart's footsteps, you know, he walked away into heaven. You know, he's not here anymore.
When Payne passed away, I lost a best friend, I lost a brother.
A part of my life that was fun.
I lost my innocence.
He was all about life. He was about living.
It's like a giant empty hole in Springfield.
There'll never be another Payne Stewart.
It's hard to tell how great the day has been until the sun sets. I don't think any of us thought the sun was setting for Payne Stewart, but it's given, I think, all of us a chance to look back and say how great the day has been.
He's here with us. I mean, I feel him all the time, and I think he'll be with us until we get to heaven and he's there to greet us. Payne and Tracy were just so much in love. And to watch them together, you could feel, even just the way they look at each other, the way he would hold her face, the way he would kiss her. They just loved each other with a love that you don't really find nowadays. To see those two together, the love that they had for one another and their family. Payne would rather be with them than anybody.
Tell me a little bit about the necklace that you're wearing.
It was my dad's. I don't know what it means, but I just wear it because it was my dad's.
Hey, God. I just lost a dear old friend. Hey, God, hope he's in your angel band. Hey, God, you know he believes. Just help me understand why you do the things you do. Hey, God, send me down some comfort, please. Hey, God, I'll be down here on my knees. Hey, God, will we ever comprehend the forgiveness and grace that lies waiting in the end? Well, there's anger and tears for all of the years that your children won't have you to hold. Though my heart has been broken, the angels have spoken, still I wish I could watch you grow old. Hey, God, I know we didn't die alone. Hey, God, tell my old friend welcome home. Hey, God, please hear me when I pray. Pray for a little peace